sun comes up.
It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again.
Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
About him.
You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to my sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what could I say? And what could I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
Completely to you.
Today's reading is found in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13 to chapter 7, verse 19. When God made his promise to Abraham, since there was no one greater for him to swear by, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you and give you many descendants. And so, after waiting patiently, Abraham received what was promised. People swear by someone greater than themselves, and the oath confirms what is said and puts an end to all argument. Because God wanted to make the unchanging nature of his purpose very clear to the heirs of what was promised, he confirmed it with an oath. God did this so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled to take hold of the hope set before us may be greatly encouraged. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain, where our forerunner, Jesus, has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. He met Abraham returning from the defeat of the kings and blessed him. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, the name Melchizedek means king of righteousness. Then also king of Salem means king of peace. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life, resembling the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of the plunder. Now the law requires the descendants of Levi who become priests to collect a tenth from the people, that is, from their fellow Israelites. Even though they are descended from Abraham, this man, however, did not trace his descent from Levi. Yet he collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. And without doubt, the lesser is blessed by the greater. In the one case, the tenth is collected by people who die. But in the other case, by giving him who is declared to be living, one might even say that Levi, who collects the tenth, paid the tenth through Abraham. Because when Melchizedek met Abraham, Levi was still in the body of his ancestor. If perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, and indeed the law given to the people established that priesthood, why was there still need for another priest to come, one in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron? For when the priesthood is changed, the law must be changed also. He of whom these things are said belonged to a different tribe, and no one from that tribe has ever served at the altar. For it is clear that our Lord descended from Judah, and in regard to that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. And what we have said is even more clear if another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest not on the basis of a regulation as to his ancestry, but on the basis of the power of an indestructible life. For it is declared, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. The former regulation is set aside because it was weak and useless, for the law made nothing perfect, and a better hope is introduced by which we draw near to God. This is the reading of God's word. You may all be seated.
Good morning, church. This is what some people are saying about the Bible being hard to understand. This is one of those chapters in the Bible which very few actually understand. And this is what I mentioned last Sunday as hard teaching. It is only for the mature. It's not for those who are still on milk. And the point of that is not to say that immaturity has to do with being childish. Maturity has to do with the completion of God's purpose for your life. Now, I need to have your full attention, especially those who are youth, because there are some words here that, well, Kaisa pronounced very well, but sometimes you can't even pronounce properly, like the word Melchizedek. Can you say that with me? Melchizedek, which comes from two words. And if you were listening intently or closely, the author actually gave the meaning of it. What was its meaning according to the reading that you just heard? Melchizedek. King of righteousness. Very good. You were a good listener. And comes from two Greek, Hebrew words, Melchi, which is king, and Zedek, which means righteous or just. So, Christ is the great high priest and king, because Melchizedek is not only a king, he's also a priest. All right? And our theme for this morning is trust this great king and priest, who is also termed as the great high priest. He's not just an ordinary priest, but a great high priest. Okay, another quiz this morning. What is a great high priest? Now, most of you would pass that test because you know that a great high priest. So you have priests, the ordinary priests, and you have one great high priest. The one great high priest, I think in my younger days, we call somebody who was the boss of our group, yung Grand High. You remember that? In the 70s or 80s, he's the Grand High because everybody follows him. The great high priest is not really a boss, but he's one guy who is assigned the task of going into the inner sanctuary, what's called the Holy of Holies. You see, the temple in Jerusalem, or the temple of Solomon, is a big place, and there is a temple, but within the temple there is an inner court or inner sanctuary or inner place called the Holy of Holies. And once a year, only once a year, can the great high priest enter the Holy of Holies. Of course, if it's such a great job and you think, oh, this guy must be the holiest among the priests, so he can go in there. In fact, it's not that. They take turns, and it's actually quite scary. Why? Because if you go in there and and God does not accept your offering, you come out dead. And how do you come out if you're dead? No? They put a rope around his feet, or 1 foot. They put around the rope around his foot, and he goes in there, and they tug at the rope to see if he's still alive, you know, after the ceremony. And when they pull, and of course he comes out without them pulling it out, then he's okay. You see it? You get the picture? Why? Because once a year, on the Day of Atonement, which is Yom Kippur, which we just celebrated, or the, not us, but the whole city of New York, because it was a holiday for most of the time. So it's actually a Day of Atonement for what? What is atonement? For making peace with God for your sin. Okay? So this was a way of God taking away the sin of his people. Get it? Okay, so let's move on. Jesus is our great high priest. This is the theme that is going to occur from now on till the end of Hebrews. And it's a great theme because it's only in this book where it is fully explained. Many times we hear about priests in our day and age. Priest is a word that is commonly used not in our religious circles but in other religions, right? Okay, what is a priest nowadays? What is a priest supposed to do? Intercede, yes? For who? For the people, okay? So, like for instance, somebody died and you will call a priest. Why? Why would you call a priest? So the priest can pray for who? Okay. For the dead. No? For the dead. Why? Because they believe that if a priest prays for the dead, then there is a chance that the dead will go to heaven. You get that? How many of you kids know that? You do? Very good, very good. Okay. But a pastor, when it comes to the family where somebody died, he's not supposed to pray for the dead. If he does, then he's not really a pastor in the sense of knowing what atonement or making peace with God is all about. It's only through Christ's death, right? So it's too late for the dead. By that time, the pastor would say, you know, we just hope that the person has a personal relationship with God and that he has accepted Christ in his heart and he's going to heaven because of that. If he doesn't know the person. But if he knows the person and he's the pastor of that person, what do you think? He should know, right? He should know. It's his business to know if that person is saved or not. So he can only give some words of advice for the family and pray for the family. Get it? Okay, and console the family in their grief. That's a priest. Well, I mean, that's a pastor. The first one is a priest. What are the other functions of a priest that you know of nowadays in other religious circles? What does a priest do, aside from praying for the dead? He what? He takes confessions from people, yes, yes. Does a pastor do that? Yeah, well, it depends what the confession is. If the confession is, Father, I have sinned, so-and-so, and the father says, okay, well, do this, do that, and you're going to be all right, right? So the confession is truly something that the person is repentant of, then the pastor can suggest ways of repairing the problem, relationship with God and with the people. Get it? Okay, come on, another one. I'm waiting for something that you're aware of. What the priest... Okay, perform weddings, funerals, baptisms. But I'm getting to the point where it says a priest, of course, does the Eucharist or the Lord's Supper, right? And so does a pastor. And what else? Does the priest also give a sermon? Yes. What is he doing there? He is saying the Mass. Okay? He says a homily, right? They call it. So the homily is a verse in the Bible that he explains too. And I've been to those. It's good that they do, as long as it's not in Latin. And it's very hard to understand. I mean, impossible for me at that. But here's the point. During the times of the Old Testament, The priest, and you know, you don't read your modern eyes into this verse. The problem with us is we hear the word priest and we think, oh, it's like the priest nowadays. No, erase that from your mind. It's not. No? Think more of the rabbi. Think more of the rabbi. In Jewish communities, what's the role of a rabbi? Teacher. If you have a problem, you go to the rabbi. Rabbi, what does the Bible, what does the Torah say? What does the law of God say? Rabbi, can you give me advice? Rabbi, should I wash my hands now? No, and that's those things are very particular. In fact, the rabbi affects your daily life. No? If you are sick in those days and you have some spots in your skin, what does the rabbi do? Now, he inspects it. And if he sees leprosy starting out, he says, unclean, unclean. Okay, you're not allowed to join us in our worship. Stay away. No? So those things. But here's the point. The priest speaks to the people for God. Huh? He's the spokesman. So as a priest, so to speak, which is the office talked about here, I speak for God to you. Now in the Old Testament, you have prophets as well who say, thus says the Lord. Correct? Some of this you already know. And how about the opposite way? Does a priest speak for the people to God? Yes. Why? Because the rabbi or the teacher has to pray. And the great high priest does something that nobody else does. He presents a sacrifice, not to God, on behalf of the people. To God, for the people. That's the opposite direction. You get it? Okay, we can move on. Why is Jesus our great high priest? And it's a very long argument. In fact, it doesn't finish here. But I didn't want you to stay standing up for more than, 2 or 3 minutes. Because it goes all the way to chapter 10. How long would that take? Reading it. No? You'll be probably saying to me, why does the pastor have such a long passage today? And then you get so confused. But I will continue. Because the great high priest, Jesus, is someone we can trust. Keep your mind on that. Okay, let me give you what that means in everyday terms. Trust. Think of somebody you trust. Think of someone you trust, and you come to that person. You know what? I really am in a mess. I mean, I have a problem. What would you do if that person is trusted, if you trust that person? You will tell it all. No? You will also ask for advice. Very good. Very good. Right? And you hope that the person understands you and gives you the right advice. Your hope is in that person. Have you ever done that? Have you actually hoped and trusted? Because you trust that person, you hope that person can help you, and that because you trust that person, you'll be okay. In other words, you'll be secure. Think of a doctor that you trust. Will you go to a doctor you don't trust? Will you go to a doctor you don't trust? No. You won't go to a doctor you don't trust. Why? Because after the doctor hears from you and tells you, take this, and you go, I don't trust that doctor anyway. So why would I take this? You get it? Now, why is that important to understand trust? Because when you don't trust somebody, when you don't trust a person, what happens? You follow what you like, but because you're hoping that that person can help you, and you can't really trust that person, you can't trust, I guess, anybody, because they can't trust, what happens? You worry. Now you worry. How am I going to solve this problem? What's going to happen to me? Get it? You worry. That's one source of worry. Now, let me go on. Why trust our great high priest and king? Why trust Jesus? Why trust God? Because this verse says God's oath and promise is absolutely trustworthy. In fact, the word hope in this book is not our modern-day use of the word hope. What's hope in Tagalog? Sana. I hope. Sana. Pag-asa. No? Umaasa. No? These are things that when you say them, sana. Maasa ako. No? When you say them, is there a tone of optimism? No. There is no tone of optimism at all in our ordinary use of the word hope. Because for us, hope is something that you wish would happen, but might not happen. So what's the difference between hope and wish? Hope is probably more possible than wish. Because when you go, when I wish upon a star, and on Disneyland, no? Disney. What happens there? Forget it. Disney won't give you what you're hoping for. A star won't give you what you're hoping for, right? But a person that you trust, especially in our Lord Jesus Christ, his promises are trustworthy. I won't belabor on that, but is there anybody else that God can swear by an oath or promise that I am here to love you and love you forever as he did with Abraham? Abraham is mentioned here, right? Abraham is cited. That God promised Abraham that he will be great and he will be the father of many nations when he himself doesn't have his own son at that point. So he trusted God. And what does the Bible say? Trusting God, God reckoned it to him as what? Righteousness. That God made Abraham right with himself because God saw that Abraham put his whole trust in God. Get it? So God could not have sworn by, you know, when you make an oath, like, you know, you stand in court and you say, put your hand in the Bible. Do you swear to tell the truth and nothing but the truth? That's swearing. I shouldn't use that word. That's an oath taking, right? So you're taking an oath that you will tell the truth. Why are you putting your hand in the Bible? Because you're saying, I'm actually making an oath, not to you judges, I'm making an oath to God that I will tell the truth. But in some cultures, in some countries even, they don't swear by the Bible anymore. They just say, I swear to tell the truth and nothing but the truth. They just stand there, right? So they're making an oath to the judge who is a higher authority than them. But since there is no higher authority than God, God swore to himself. Get that? Okay. Clearing that up, where have you heard about swearing to himself? Except in this book. No? But it's in Psalm 110. It's there. I will make you a king in the order of Melchizedek. And that's been mentioned over and over again. What's this make a king in the order of Melchizedek? Order? That's what you do in a restaurant when you want something to eat. No, I mean, what's that? That's not that order. Or is it order in terms of... you know, let's have order, peace and order. No? That's not either. The order here has to do with the word in Greek as taxis, which means a type of. Like, you know, Brother Louis, taxidermy, right? You know, this word in medical science, taxis has to do with a type of. No? But the taxis they're talking about here is the fact that Christ is a type of Melchizedek. Why? What's so special about this Melchizedek? It says he had no mother or father. Is that possible? Who had no mother or father? Only Christ, isn't it? When he was born. Oh, he did have a mother, but in reality, that mother wasn't really his mother by being God, but it's a human person. So the mother and father of Melchizedek is known, but we don't know who it is. That's what the Bible author is saying. He just came in the scene. When was that? And if you're interested in this, and I haven't got time to take it up, you will find it in Genesis 14. Abraham just came from rescuing his nephew Lot from the kings surrounding the area. And when he came back from conquering the kings and taking back Lot and all his family and all his goods, he actually went to Melchizedek and offered a blessing to Melchizedek, because Melchizedek is a priest. Okay? What does it say? King of which place? Salem. What's Salem? Again, peace. No? He's the king of peace, of Salem. And most people think that's Jerusalem. Okay, now, continuing. You know, many times we can say things like, so why would we trust this great high priest and king, Jesus? You know, Abraham, when he came back and gave a blessing, actually gave a tithe, is the word used, right? A tenth, no? To Melchizedek. And this gets a bit complicated, because he gives a blessing to Melchizedek, and at the same time, Melchizedek pronounces a blessing on him. Why? Because a priest's job is also to say, bless you, my son, right? Bless you. In fact, I see you sometimes come up to church and you get your children, oh, mag-bless ka kay pastor. No? You want me to bless your child? And then after I say, oh, bless you, ano, bless you, and go, thanks, pastor. That's part of the job description. And for me, that's very good, because you're saying that God's favor will rest on your son because of your pastor's prayer for your son. And please, you know, believe me, I do pray when I see your kids running around here. It reminds me. That doesn't mean if your kids are not here, I don't pray for them. I also make sure that I try to remember each family. But I digress. The point is this. The point is this. When Abraham gave a blessing to Melchizedek in terms of a tithe, and Melchizedek gave a blessing to Abraham, you have here an illustration of what Christ in his death on the cross does. This is a great illustration. Why is it a great illustration? Where do the priests and the high priests, where do they come from? From which tribe? From the tribe of Levi. Okay. From the tribe of Levi. But is Jesus from the tribe of Levi? No. Where is he from? He's from the tribe of Judah. He's the Lion of Judah, we say, right? Now, that's the problem. If Christ is not from the tribe of Levi, how can he be a priest, let alone a great high priest? That makes sense? So somebody will come up and say, this Jesus, he's not really a priest, because he does not come from the tribe of Levi. Is this nitpicking? For sure. It's nitpicking for sure, because it's so important. How can the Savior come from the tribe of Judah? And this is the explanation. Because Christ is like Melchizedek. He doesn't come from the tribe of Levi, although he's a priest. Period. I don't want to go on from that, because it'll get more complicated. Just understand that. Huh? And secondly, this is a case of, you know, when we give our offering, when we tithe, when we give our pledges, you're giving an offering, you think, to God. You think to God. Now, of course, this is just a portion of what you're offering to God. The portion that is tenth of your giving. By the way, I know some people who reverse tithe. They give 90% instead of just 10. Reverse tithing. And God has blessed that person and expanded his business and so much that he supports a lot of missionaries and workers. But that's beside the point. The point is this. When we give to God, this is an illustration, this particular tenth of Melchizedek being given a tithe by Abraham. Listen, does Levi come from Abraham? Question. Yes. Because how many tribes were the sons of Israel, 12, and Levi, Aaron, all them were part of this family of Abraham. Father Abraham had many sons. Remember that song? Silly song, but anyway. The point is that, look, Abraham gave a tithe to Melchizedek. But Abraham will later on have Levi, from whom the priests come from. So Levi, in effect, although he's not around yet, and the priests that follow him are offering to who? To who at that point of this passage? To Melchizedek. Have I lost you? Are you still following me? So when Abraham gave an offering to Melchizedek, but Levi will come from Melchizedek. I'm sorry. Levi will come from Abraham. Thank you, my dear. So Levi will come from Abraham, right? I should have drawn it. Maybe I can get Pastor TJ to illustrate this point. Can you stand up and just humor me? We'll pretend you are Melchizedek. Okay? Okay. And then we have a small kid here in our... John, come on. You'll be my son. My future son. Somewhere down the centuries and generations. John is Levi, right? From whom the priest will come. And pretend I'm Abraham. There's the king and priest, Melchizedek. Okay? Stand like a king. So a king. Yes, very good. Okay, pretending a king. He's King Melchizedek, right? I'm offering to him a tithe. A tenth of the blessing that I received because I was able to conquer the kings who took Lot away. Make sense? But this guy who's going to come after me will become the priest who will offer to who? To God, not him, right? The priest will offer to God. Get it? So imagine behind Melchizedek and represented by Melchizedek is God. The priests are offering to God. Make sense? But there's even more. Pretend that the priests, after this priest will come Christ. Correct? Christ. But he's not from this tribe, from Levi's. Where is he from? From the tribe of Judah, but he is like Melchizedek. So Christ is here too. So who is the giver and who is the receiver of the tithe? Okay, God is the receiver, Melchizedek, like the king, and priest. But who is the giver? Behind Melchizedek is Jesus Christ. So now you see, Christ is both the giver of the tithe and the receiver of the tithe. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Let's give them a round of applause. Very good. That's better than any drawing I can do. I'm not very good at drawing either. So the point is this. And this is what the Hebrews are imagining too. If Christ doesn't come from the order of Levi, he comes from the order of Melchizedek, a king who has no beginning and no end, who lives forever. Christ is offering a sacrifice to God, but he's also the one who's receiving it. So his sacrifice on the cross, his atonement for us that he did, is to satisfy the one who will receive the offering of himself. When you tithe, when you give your offering, you're not just giving a tenth of you're giving your life to God. That's the point of that as well. Make sense? So what's so great about this illustration? There's more. You see, when we trust God, the one who made the sacrifice, Christ, fully satisfies the one demanding a sacrifice, the tithe. Christ is the new Melchizedek. Our Lord and Jesus Christ is the great high priest. And I have more to say about that in the next future sermon. I'm not ending yet, but I'm telling you that there will be more. Because Christ is the hope. Let's go back to that word hope. Because hope in the Hebrew Bible, in the Hebrew chapter is not like the hope we have of pag-asa, of sana, of hoping not optimistically. Why? Because later on in Hebrews chapter 11, it says hope or faith is what? Is the assurance of things hoped for. Assurance. Assurance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. So have you seen heaven? Some people will claim that. Have you seen someone being taken up to heaven and meeting God? I don't know about these claims. But the point is that I haven't seen that. And neither have you. I don't have any evidence for it. But this hope is for sure. This hope is 100% sure. It's not an optimism. It's a security. So if you want to be secure in Christ, trust the new Melchizedek. Because he offered the sacrifice that he himself demanded. Can you get any better than that? It's a better hope. That's what the next sermon will be on Sunday. Christ offers to us a better hope, a better future, a better life, and hopefully a better community of the church. Hopefully there is not a wish. It's a reality. Although we may be going through some tough times as a community, God has promised that there is a better hope. Let me give you a few more. Why trust Christ? This is from verse 7, 1 to 10. Because Christ is the new Melchizedek. He goes on further. Because the old system of priesthood, the sacrifices and the blessings, doesn't work. Then why did God give it? You know, if it doesn't work. Why killing sheep and killing, cows or oxen and offer them as a sacrifice if it doesn't work? So were they just making all these gestures and no effect? No. They were just illustrations. They were supposed to tell the people, I will provide the sacrifice in the future for which you are making the offering now. Remember Abraham when he was told to sacrifice Isaac? And Isaac asked, but Father, where's the sacrifice? And Abraham said, God will provide the sacrifice, my son. And the ram was caught in the thorn bush, and they sacrificed to that. That ram that was caught in the thorn bush represents who? Jesus Christ, who will be the one who will replace this old system of sacrifices. Because it doesn't really take away their sin. It signifies something in the future which will take away their sin. So some people ask me, does that mean that Old Testament people were saved because they did the sacrifice? Yes. Because they trusted that the sacrifice represents Christ. Do they know who is going to be the sacrifice and who has come in the future as their Messiah? No. But they trusted God. They knew that God was going to fulfill His promise. That a Messiah will come who will take away your sin. The Lamb of God who takes away sin of you and I. Okay. Because this sacrifices of goats, sheep, and cattle will ultimately not restore people's broken relationship with God. People come to priests because they want to get near God. They want to be forgiven of their sin. Even if you talk about confession of the ordinary priests nowadays, but at that time, people knew that they needed something to take away their sin. Okay. What can ultimately restore people's relationship with Christ? What can wash away all my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us, ano sabi? Whole again. Whole again because you're now restored to a close, intimate relationship with God. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And here are some applications. Applications are supposed to be practical, but these things I've taught you, trust our great high priest. Put your security in him, not on people, not on events or things, and not even priests and pastors. Put your whole trust in Jesus. Why? Because if we put our trust in people, in things, in our status, in our careers, in our jobs, what happens? We grumble. We worry. And we lose the joy of our salvation. I said we, because I grumble too. Last Sunday, you noticed me grumbling. Forgive me for grumbling. I've already asked God to forgive you. I knew some of you were saying things like, something is different about the pastor this Sunday. That's not him. And some of you noticed how, you know, I lost confidence in what I was doing because I was bothered by those things that caused me to grumble. And please don't ask me what it is, okay? Specifically. It's something that needs to be settled. It needs to be worked out. And God will work it out. Amen? Don't grumble. Because your modern day priests cannot perfect you. What are your modern day priests? I'm not referring to just religious priests. I'm talking about even the things that happen in our society, in our world, in our culture. If only this community cared about what I care for, then it'll be a better place to live in. And I'm referring to not just our community as a church, but our community here in New York, our community as in US or the Philippines or whatever. And I must admit, I also grumble about that. And forgive me again if I grumble too much and you see that as being political. But the point is this. When you grumble, you end up going in circles that has no exit, or you don't exit the right way. Remember this? That's Moses, and those are the Israelites wandering in the wilderness. And he's saying, good news, just 40 laps around the wilderness for disobeying God. Bad news, each lap takes a year. And you know, if you've been to Israel, you will see how small that wilderness is. You can cover it in a day. But because there are many people around the area, many kings and so on fighting them, they couldn't get in to the promised land. So the bad news is, if you grumble, you'll never get to what God has intended for your life and mine. Make sense? So don't grumble. Nextly, don't worry. God has our future in His hands. Christ has provided the better hope. Christ is our security. Christ has secured for us a place in heaven, and He has secured for us a way to trust Him in our present circumstances. Whether you're worried that your kids will not have a good future and you need to work so much, or you want to have your own home because you want your kids to be established, don't worry. Place those things in God's hands. What does it say? Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things. Sometimes we think, oh, we're worrying because we're not seeking first the kingdom of God. No, it's not just that. You're not putting your trust in Christ. You're not putting your hope in your anchor of life. Trevin Wax said, like roundabouts, and you know this roundabouts? Have you seen a roundabout like this in America? With 5 exits? You have. Okay, first time I saw it was in Australia, and I went in, and I kept going around because, where's my exit? No, I couldn't figure out the exit, and in fact, I think a car bumped me. It wasn't my old car, my old Subaru. I didn't care, they just sped off. No, they didn't care either. So I was trying to get out, but you know how hard it is to get out. The point is, he says, it's like roundabouts, except you don't get off at the right exit. It keeps you running the race that God intends for you to run. You get distracted, in other words. Worrying, picturing things that, you know, this is going to happen. Oh no, I'm going to be done with. I'm going to lose my job. I'm going to lose my wife. I'm going to lose my kids. I'm going to lose everything. And you worry to no end. You're not accomplishing God's purpose for your life because you think you have the future in your hands. When I was a young man, I worked the first time and I thought I was going to lose my job. And this is because I felt like I wasn't doing what I should be doing as a teacher. I mean, sorry, my first good paying job. Because I had a job that paid very little and I didn't care if I lost that job. No? But when I got a job that was giving us comfort in life, and this is the job in International School of Manila, I feared losing my job. Because I was exposed to endless evaluations. Evaluation by coordinator, department, evaluation by co-teacher, evaluation by students. And by that time you think, with all these evaluations, something's gonna go wrong, isn't it? And you live in times like these too. You're getting evaluated at work and you worry. But you know what? Never happened. I never lost my job, even in so many jobs I've had in the past. I was worrying about something that really wouldn't happen. Maybe you are worried about things that might happen to you or to others, or even worrying about what's going to happen to us as a church. It's not in your hands. The future is not in your hands. The future of your family, the future of your marriage, the future of your life with the church, with the community. Thank you, Mike, for warning me. I didn't see the time, but thank you. But let me end here. Don't what? The first one? Grumble. And the second one? Those are both negatives, right? But they have positives. Trust God, trust God, trust Jesus. There's a third one. Be joyful in your salvation. Are you joyful in your salvation?
Yes.
Let me see it. By not grumbling, not worrying. No? And by, let me give you some more positive ways of showing joy in your salvation. I don't often do this, but I felt the Spirit telling me, tithe. And some of you may be against tithing and saying, Pastor, that's Old Testament stuff. Give at least 10% of your income. Why? Because Abraham tithed. He gave 10% of his blessing that he got from conquering the other kings to Melchizedek. Trust God for your future. Because tithing is a sign of your full trust in God's provision. And that's why he's going to give you more. You trust me? Here's more. Because I can trust you with what I've given you. I can expound on that later on. But let me go to the next one. Live sacrificially for others. There is no better life, I tell you, than giving of yourself to others and giving up a lot of things and creature comforts for others. Because it will come back to you. Not in terms of material blessing, but on what God is going to show you about the changes in their lives that he's been able to use you to change other people's lives. That's the motto of a teacher, isn't it? Teacher, you don't get much pay, but you know that sooner down the track, people will have a better life, changed life. And lastly, love. Love even though your whole being revolts about loving the unlovable. Why? Because then you will prove that you are a follower of Christ. Because Christ was crucified and yet he loved the people who put him there. So much so that he gave his life for them. But that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.